Turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 13, and we'll begin in Acts 13 today. Acts chapter 13, starting at verse 1. Now, there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. And as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them." And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. Now, what I want you to notice in that beginning passage in the book of Acts, chapter 13, is the phrase, "the Holy Ghost said." The Holy Ghost was speaking during the New Testament era and sending out believers forth on missionary journeys. And so the question is, does the Holy Spirit continue to speak and to guide Christians today on a personal level? And there are two extreme views when it comes to approaching this topic. One is the charismatic Pentecostal view, where people are falling down on the ground, what they call being slain in the spirit, or barking madly like dogs, behaving disorderly, and generally acting demon-possessed. So that's one extreme, is this Pentecostal view. And then there is the cessationist view that most fundamental Baptists hold to, which says that everything that God wants to tell us is in His written word, and that the Holy Spirit no longer speaks or gives special revelation to His people, not even on a personal and individual level. In other words, cessationists, those who hold to the view that the Holy Ghost is silent today and that God no longer gives dreams or visions or words of knowledge by revelation of His Spirit, hold to the view that all of this has ceased. That's why they're called cessationists. Now, personally, I hold to the view that the Holy Ghost is active in believers' lives and does continue to speak to believers at His discretion when He speaks to us in our inner man in the Spirit. And I'm not talking about hearing an audible voice like Moses heard at the burning bush, or when Jesus heard when He was baptized in the Jordan. God's voice through the ministry of the Holy Ghost is spiritual, because the Holy Ghost Himself is a spirit and so speaks to us in a spiritual manner today. Now, in John 16:13, Jesus says, "Howbeit when He, the Spirit of truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth. For He shall not speak of Himself, but whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak, and He will show you things to come." Now, primarily that passage in John 16 is speaking of the full revelation of Jesus Christ, which the Holy Spirit would manifest to the churches of God through the apostles, who would then in turn write the scriptures. That's the primary application of John 16:13. But John 16:13 also reveals to us that the function of the Spirit is to guide believers into understanding all truth. And one example of that is how we are able ourselves as individual believers to understand the scriptures by revelation of the Holy Ghost. You know, the natural man doesn't understand the scriptures in their entirety. They might grasp bits and pieces of it or have some intellectual knowledge of parts of it, but it's the Holy Ghost that quickens the word so that we understand the Bible in its full context as believers. And we see that in 1 Corinthians 2:14, which says, "But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned." So it's the Holy Spirit that quickens the word and makes it fully comprehensible to the believer's minds. So that's one function of the Holy Ghost, is to enable believers to understand His written word. But how far does the ministry of the Holy Spirit extend to believers today? We know he guides us in understanding his word. We know that he seals us unto the day of redemption and indwells us as believers. But does God speak to believers directly and personally? Can he guide us and direct our paths supernaturally? Does he continue to pour out dreams and visions upon his own people? Does he time events in order to coincide in our favor? Now, before I answer these questions that are often very controversial within conservative circles of the church, such as the Independent Fundamental Baptists and other cessationists who completely disregard the ministry of the Holy Ghost in these matters, what I want to make clear, you know, before we begin, absolutely clear, is that the written word of God is the final authority on all matters of doctrine. So if a believer hears something in the spirit, in the inner man, it is never going to go against the grain and the authority of the Bible. In other words, there is no new doctrine. So false prophets like Joseph Smith or Islam's Muhammad saying that they have new revelation from God, which goes against the core teachings of the gospel, is not actually from God, but from the devil. So everything that God wants us to know in terms of doctrine is revealed to us in the written word. Okay, so I just want to make that super clear. But God continues to speak to our inner man, what the Bible calls our inner man, which is our inner spirit, our being, through his Holy Spirit, giving us personal revelation at his discretion. Another way to think of this is that general revelation is complete, but personal revelation in guiding us in our personal lives is ongoing for the purpose of edification of the church and the believer. And so today we're going to look at the Bible, at some of the instances where the Holy Spirit is active among believers in the New Testament. And I'm going to share some personal supernatural experiences that I've encountered over the years, which I attribute to the work of the Holy Ghost. And we're also going to look at some of the verses that cessationists use to claim that all communication from the Holy Spirit ended with the death of the apostles, because that's their claim. And I'm going to refute some of those verses. Now, I've already mentioned Acts 13, what we began with, where the Holy Spirit spoke directly to the church and sent forth Paul and Barnabas on a missionary journey. Look also at Acts 16, starting at verse 6. Just a few chapters over, Acts 16, starting at verse 6. Let's read 6 through 10. Now, when they had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden by the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. Now, that's very peculiar. The Holy Ghost actually forbid the apostles and the believers to preach in a particular area in Asia. Verse 7, after that, after they were come to Mysia, they essayed to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. Again, he forbid them. And they, passing by Mysia, came down to Troas. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. And after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. Now, it's very peculiar and a very unique instance of Scripture where the Holy Ghost actually forbids Paul and the believers to preach the gospel in a certain area. Because we have this mentality today that we just go systematically into every area and preach the gospel. And that's fine. We normally do that. But there are instances where the Holy Ghost directly and specifically guided believers, as we see in the Bible, to preach in specific areas. And so we see that happening in the Scriptures. And some might say, well, that was just for the Apostle Paul. And I'm going to examine that claim in a minute. But first, let's look at how the Holy Spirit worked in the early church. Look also at Acts 20, starting at verse 22. Acts 20, 22. We see another instance of this. Acts 20, 22. And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem. This is Paul speaking. Not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me, but none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish the course with joy. And he goes on to preach about his ministry. But we see that the Holy Ghost was witnessing to him and speaking to Paul and telling him that bonds and afflictions would await him as he preached the gospel in various areas. So God, we see in two instances at least, and there are many more, was directly guiding the Apostle Paul in ministry and in the preaching of the word. In this case, he was warning and preparing Paul so that he would be comforted, knowing that God was with him as he was being afflicted. Now, some will say, well, Paul was an apostle, that's why God was speaking to him. But what about Philip? Okay, we have an example of Philip, who was a deacon and an evangelist who won the Ethiopian eunuch to the Lord in the book of Acts chapter 8. And there's more examples. We're going to begin with apostles, deacons, and then see where others also God spoke to. So it's not just the apostles and the deacons. It's not just, you know, a certain select number of people. It's many believers. So Philip was a deacon and an evangelist. And starting in Acts 8, turning back to Acts 8, starting at verse 26, the Bible says, "And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise, and go toward the south unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert." So an angel comes and speaks to Philip, and he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, an eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariot, reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, "Go near and join thyself to this chariot." And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah, and said, "Understand thou what thou readest," and began to preach the gospel unto the Ethiopian eunuch. So we see that, again, the Holy Ghost said unto Philip. So we see that at least in the very early church, the ministry of the Holy Ghost was directly speaking to believers, was active in the ministry of preaching the gospel. He was directing them on who to preach to and where to preach. And one of the reasons that stories like this are recorded in Scripture is to set an example for us today in our ministry of preaching the gospel. It's written for a historical record as well, but it's also an example to us. We know that all Scripture is written for doctrine and for our, you know, for our example, so that we know how to preach the gospel and how to live our lives. Now, in my own encounters of soul winning, the reason I believe this is because I've encountered this numerous times when we've been out preaching the gospel. And there have been numerous times when the Holy Ghost has specifically directed us on where and when to preach. And souls were won as a result of obedience to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now, if no souls were won, I would say, okay, you know, maybe I'm wrong. But whenever we've listened to that leading of the Spirit and gone where God has told us to preach, we have seen supernatural encounters with people who are just waiting for us there to preach to them. So one example, about 10 months ago, I was preaching the gospel with Brother Marshall, and we would always pray beforehand and ask God to reveal to us where to preach that week. Now, one week, God spoke to my spirit to go to one of the local campuses and to preach the gospel on the campus. So we went, and I thought, you know, the most logical place that I could think about to preach when we got there was just at the entrance of the campus where students were going in and out. And so we thought, let's go by the entrance, we'll stand at the sidewalk, and we'll preach the gospel there. And we preached to people for about 2 hours straight, and nobody got saved, and people were not that receptive to the gospel. You know, so for 2 hours straight, just standing on the street. And I thought, well, I guess, you know, it's just one of those days, and you know, I was wrong, and let's just pack it up and go home. But then as we literally start to pack up and get our Bibles and get things together, I hear the voice of the Holy Ghost speaking to my inner man, saying, step onto the campus. And I remember as he told me that he had told me earlier in the week to go actually onto the campus, but we hadn't done that yet. So after those 2 hours, you know, we step onto the campus and we start preaching the gospel. And literally within 10 minutes of being on the campus, a girl is sitting there on a bench, and we preach the gospel to her, and she gets saved. And you know, she tells us that she had been praying all week, asking for answers from God. She had been confused as to whether salvation was by works, or you know, and faith, or whether it was by faith alone. And she was really struggling with this, and she's, you know, broke into tears a bit, and we preached the gospel to her, and she was just like, I felt like I was just sitting here waiting for an answer, and you guys came and preached the gospel to me. And she ended up praying the prayer, admitting she's a sinner, putting her faith on Jesus Christ alone for salvation, and she was saved. So I have these personal testimonies in my own life where, as I said, there's no new revelation, there's no new doctrine, but personally, God has guided me in preaching of the gospel to the saving of souls. Now, if you don't want to believe that, I know people in here do, but there are people who will say this is, you know, not from God, and but, you know, or it's demonic, or that I'm crazy or whatever. But you know, when there's a testimony like that, you know, it's God isn't going to cast out demons by the spirit of Beelzebub, or Satan isn't going to cast out demons, you know, by the spirit of Beelzebub. We're not going to go against, people aren't going to get saved through the work of the devil, you know, so people are actually getting saved. Now, if we had not been leading, you know, open to the leading of the spirit, we would have never been on that campus in the first place. And that girl would not have gotten saved. And so we see that both in scripture and in our personal testimony, that the Holy Spirit continues to guide and lead the church in preaching the gospels, the gospel. But cessationists claim that these portions of scripture are only a matter of historical record and that they have no relevance for us today. But I say that God recorded this portion of scripture because he expects us to be open to the leading of his spirit when preaching the gospel. The Holy Ghost is active today in the ministry of the word and of the preaching of the gospel. Why would God stop guiding his church and leave us to our own abilities and our own intellect apart from the leading of his spirit? You know, especially as we enter into the end times, where we're beginning to see the falling away and the great apostasy start to come to pass as doctrines are failing and churches are failing. We need his guidance more than ever today. And it's a shame that people, that Christians, will deny the powerful work of the Holy Spirit in our midst. In fact, the Apostle Paul himself laid down clear instructions to the churches on the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So turn to 1 Corinthians 12, and we'll actually see not only personal testimony from me, but actually instruction from Paul the Apostle to the churches. So 1 Corinthians chapter 12, this is the key passage on spiritual gifts. Now, the last few chapters of 1 Corinthians 12 is a sort of church instruction manual on how churches ought to operate. Okay, in chapter 11, Paul addresses how the Lord's Supper should be taken in a worthy manner. In chapter 13, Paul addresses the importance of charity. In chapter 14, Paul addresses the participatory nature of church, discusses how prophets are to speak two or three in an orderly fashion, and how women are to keep silent in churches. So Paul is laying down instructions on how to run a church, of what the structures and the organization of the church should be. And in chapter 12, Paul dedicates an entire chapter to spiritual gifts of the Holy Ghost, to the leading of the Spirit. And so when you consider that the final chapters in Corinthians are about the very structure, organization, and ecclesiology of the church, you have to ask why Paul would dedicate an entire chapter to spiritual gifts in chapter 12 if those gifts were to be done away with a generation later. So 1 Corinthians 12, let's just take a look at that. So, beginning right there in verse 1. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, so he's speaking to the whole church, not to apostles, I would not have you ignorant. Ye know that ye were Gentiles, carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. So the dumb idols, by contrast, they don't speak, unlike the Holy Ghost. So there's a lot of context in this showing that the Holy Ghost speaks. In verse 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. So even our profession of faith itself, not just, you know, lying about Jesus being Lord or mocking, but actually genuinely professing Christ as Lord, comes by the Holy Ghost. We can't even profess his lordship unless the Holy Ghost is working within us. In verse 4, now, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. So Paul acknowledges up front in a plain statement that there are diversities of gifts. There are different gifts given to us by the Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. What's a manifestation? It's the, you know, God manifests himself. He presents himself. He shows himself. So the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. On some level, every believer, it says, has the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. For to one, and then he describes in more detail, for to one is given by the Spirit, the word of wisdom. To another, the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. I mean, these are, you know, words of knowledge, words of wisdom. Our ability to speak wisdom and knowledge comes from the Holy Ghost, by revelation, you know, of the Holy Ghost and the study of his word, the knowledge that God gives us. But then he mentions gifts of healing by the same Spirit. So we see here that there are gifts of healing that Paul addresses within the church. We see that reiterated in James 5:14. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. So even James says, pray for the sick, anoint them with oil. Why aren't Christians doing this within the Baptist churches? Because they neglect 1 Corinthians 12. They don't believe it. They don't preach on it. You know, but I'm going to preach from every chapter of the Bible. That's our goal in this church. And we're not going to add our own interpretation to it. We're going to see what the word says and go by that. So there's no reason that Paul would talk about gifts of healing if it was to be done away with. You know, this was general instruction to the churches, to every believer. And it says nowhere that these gifts will fail or end at the death of the apostles. In verse 10, to another, the working of miracles, not to the apostles, but to another. Okay, although the apostles did miraculous signs and wonders, this is showing, generally speaking, that it's not just limited to the apostles. These gifts are available to every man who is in Christ. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. You know, you ever look at someone and you just know that there's demon possession or there's demonic influence going on? That's the discerning of spirits. You know, we need to be able to discern when someone is being influenced by the devil. To another, diverse kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the self same Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. So it says it's at God's discretion who he divides these gifts to. And there's no restriction upon who he will choose. It's not up to the church to decide. It's not up to the pastors to say that he doesn't do this. He will divide to every man severally as he will. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. So all these gifts of the Spirit are for the edification of the body of Christ. And so we need to be open to receiving the gifts of the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. So, and I can boldly proclaim that because I'm not relying on some false gospel. We believe in salvation by faith alone. We believe in once saved, always saved. We believe the King James Bible is the Word of God. You know, so there are many charismatic or Pentecostal people who have a fake gospel and they go disorderly and crazy with it. That's not what we're talking about. So keep reading. Let's just skip over to verse 28 because there's a lot in that chapter, speaking of the body of Christ. But in verse 28, Paul says, "And God hath set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues." So again, it's reiterated that it's not just, you know, helps and governments and this, but and teachers, but there's also gifts of healings. There's also miracles that can occur. I'm not going to limit God and put him in a box and say those things are done away with. Verse 29, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? Why would it mention that are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? Well, that by implication, that means that some do. Verse 31, but covet earnestly the best gift. So he tells us to covet these gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. So Paul affirms the gifts of the Spirit, but then he tells them that he's going to show them an even more excellent way than just seeking spiritual gifts, which we should speak. So again, these are general instructions given to the churches in a very general and broad manner. It was these gifts, these instructions were broadly given to all believers in all churches in all ages to study and model their churches after. And what's ironic, though, is that cessationists will use the very next chapter as their number one passage to refute the gifts of the Spirit. Even though Paul just got through an entire chapter on it, they'll use 1 Corinthians 13 to say that the gifts have now ceased with the death of the apostles and that it no longer happens. And they use 1 Corinthians 13, which is a very beautiful and somewhat poetic way of saying that love is greater than knowledge, and that spiritual gifts, while good, are not to be the ultimate of what Christians should seek, that Christians ought to be characterized rather by charity or by love. But those who deny the work of the Spirit will use it to say that the gifts have ended. So let's look at what they use. 1 Corinthians 13, 8 through 12 is what they generally will quote. Actually, they won't even quote the whole thing, but they'll take just a verse out of context. But let's look at the whole context. 1 Corinthians 13, charity never faileth, but where there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. So let's stop there, because that's what they use as verse 10. They use the phrase, for when the perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. And they say that passage refers to the canon of the Scripture, that once the apostles write the Bible, the whole Bible, the New Testament, which had not been written yet, that that's perfect and the imperfect shall be done away with. But that's so out of context. It's so extraneous to that verse. When the perfect is come, if you approach this passage without that preconceived notion in mind, when the perfect is come is talking about the return of Jesus Christ. It's talking about the second coming. Isn't that obvious when you look at it without an agenda? You know, once we're in heaven, what need will there be for prophecy and for spiritual gifts. Because now we prophesy in part, we know in part, but then face to face. And we see that in the rest of the passage, which proves it in verse 11. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now, we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. That's a clear reference to meeting Jesus, to being known as I am known, you know, as we know each other in heaven. Speaking of heaven, it's speaking of seeing the Lord face to face. It's speaking of having perfect knowledge once we get to heaven versus the impartial knowledge that we have now as temporal beings, which now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. So fundamentalists and cessationists will not read the rest of that passage. They just isolate passages like they're so good at doing on numerous false doctrines, which they favor because of their man-made traditions. So 1 Corinthians 13, if you think about it, actually affirms the presence of spiritual gifts, because Paul was admonishing believers not to boast and get puffed up in their spiritual gifts, which he just, you know, finished admonishing them in the very previous chapter, but rather to emphasize godly love for the brethren. That is the greatest thing. You can have prophecy and see visions, but if you don't have charity, you're nothing. You're tinkling cymbal and sounding brass is what he says. That's the context. Okay, it's about the canon of the scripture. No, it doesn't say that anywhere in that chapter. It's completely taken out of context. So, and the final chapter, final verse in chapter 12 on spiritual gifts confirms that, because in that same, the very previous chapter, chapter 12, 31 says, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto a more excellent way. So we already talked about that, but just the continuity of those chapters affirms it. Paul said also in 1 Corinthians 14:1, in the very next chapter, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that ye may prophesy. So even after chapter 13, again, he says, follow after charity, be loving, but and desire spiritual gifts, because they're not going to cease when I die. You know, seek them out, and rather that ye prophesy, but rather that ye may prophesy. And another passage that cessationists use is Hebrews 1. Again, misapplying the context to say that spiritual gifts have ceased. Look at Hebrews 1, starting at verse 1. Hebrews 1. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. So they'll say that, you know, God spoke to us in the past by prophets through prophecy, but in these last times, God now only speaks to us by his Son. You know, and so, and then they equate that with the written word and say the gifts of the Holy Spirit have ended. There's no more healing. There's no more visions. There's no more prophecy. And that's over with, because now Jesus is what it's talking about. But all this is saying within its context is that Jesus is the culmination of all the work of the prophets and the prophecies concerning him. It's not talking about the cessation of spiritual gifts in that passage. It's extraneous, this private interpretation that they have to the text. It's simply a parallel to Acts 10:43, which says, to him, speaking of Jesus, give all the prophets witness that through his name, whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. So again, it's just talking about Jesus as the final prophet, as the final revelation. You know, there's no more new doctrine. There's no other way to get saved. All the prophets testified about the gospel, speaking of the coming of the Messiah, and he's here. Does that mean now the Holy Ghost is dumb and silent and no longer speaks to his people to guide them on a personal, individual level? You know, it's just, it's completely adding to the Bible, which they're so good at doing. The Bible says also that there are, actually the Bible shows that there are numerous prophets that are mentioned in the New Testament. The Bible says that Philip, the evangelist who I mentioned earlier, also had four daughters who were prophets. Acts 21:9, speaking of Philip, says, "And the same man had four daughters, virgins, which did prophesy." And people will say, well, prophets just means to preach, which in some cases it can, but it's not the only meaning of that word. But we see from the context of the same chapter that prophesy meant to see and to, or to hear and to proclaim future events by God, by the Holy Spirit. Because Acts 21:9 is, we just mentioned the four prophets. In the very next verse, Acts 21:10, speaks of another prophet named Agabus. And it says, "And as we tarried there many days, there came down from Judea a certain prophet named Agabus. And when he was come unto us, he took Paul's girdle and bound his own hands and feet and said, Thus saith the Holy Ghost, so shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man that owneth this girdle and shall deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles." So after the mention of the four women prophets, Agabus, a New Testament prophet, is mentioned. This was well after the initiation of the new covenant under Jesus's blood. You know, Jesus had initiated the new covenant and prophets were prophesying. And so when you look at that context, prophecy of Agabus and Philip's four daughters, they were prophets in the traditional sense of the word. That's biblical proof for that. Now, the prophet Agabus is also mentioned in Acts 11, where he accurately predicts future events. In Acts 11, starting at verse 27, it says, "And in these days came prophets from Jerusalem unto Antioch, and there stood up one of them named Agabus." So there were multiple prophets that were prophesying, "and signified by the Spirit that there should be great dearth," which is famine, "throughout all the world, which came to pass in the days of Claudius Caesar." So they predicted future events in the New Testament, in the New Testament era. There's also Cornelius the centurion, a Gentile who had a vision which led to his salvation, as recorded in the book of Acts. Now, Cornelius didn't even know Jesus Christ as a savior yet. He was a Jew by spirit. He had faith, but he didn't even know that Jesus is the Messiah yet. And God gave him a vision which led to his salvation. So Acts 10, starting at verse 1, "There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band, a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave alms to the people and prayed to God alway. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius." So we see in this passage, he had a vision of an angel coming to him. And this supernatural encounter of the Holy Ghost through a vision led to Cornelius's salvation. And so we see that God even gives visions and works miraculously in the lives of those he is drawing unto himself. Now, it's rare, but it happens. You know, Brother Marshall is one example of that. And so let me tell you how Brother Marshall got saved. It's a really incredible story. It was January 1994, about 23 years ago. I was saved for about a week or two myself. I was just a babe in Christ at the time. And I was at Marshall's house preaching the gospel to him. And it was very late in the morning. It was about 4 a.m. because we had stayed up all night at some coffee houses, which stayed open really late in those days. And we were just doing, you know, worldly things and partying or whatever at that time before we were saved. And I had just become saved. And I went to Marshall's house afterwards because he took off. And so I went to his house to preach the gospel to Marshall, because it was bursting, out of me. I needed to tell my best friend at the time, how to get saved. And nobody else that I knew in my family was saved. None of my friends were saved. I was the only one. And so I went to his house and I began preaching the gospel to him, and Marshall didn't want to hear it, and I didn't blame him, because a few weeks ago, I didn't want to hear it either. We were very opposed to Christianity. It seemed very trite. It seemed very, silly the way that these Christians, thought that they were the only ones that knew the truth. And so we were arguing against Christianity, myself in particular, probably even more so. And so I told Marshall, I said, "Marshall, I have something, I have to tell you something. And it's very serious. I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord." And he just shut me down. He's like, "Shut up. I don't want to hear this, And I said, "No." I said, "Marshall, you have to listen to me. Jesus Christ is Lord, and it's the end of the world." And as I said, it's the end of the world, because I really believed it was, before my words could fall to the ground, the biggest earthquake of our lives hit at that precise moment. I mean, it was like within a millisecond of me saying that. And we fell to the ground and we're pleading to God, "Lord, stop. Don't come back yet. Don't come back." We really thought it was the end of the world. I mean, we were convinced. This was the 1994 Northridge earthquake in California. And we were about 10 minutes away from the epicenter. And, it was the biggest earthquake ever, that we'd experienced. Freeway bridges collapsed. Apartment buildings crumbled to the ground. Houses were destroyed. People died. But Marshall Marcus ended up getting saved that day. Now, talk about powerful, Holy Spirit-led soul winning. I want that kind of soul winning, minus the earthquakes. But I want some supernatural confirmation of the Holy Ghost when we preach the gospel, because that saves people. And there's no reason to restrict the outpouring of the Holy Ghost when it's done in an orderly fashion, the way that the Bible speaks. But denying the supernatural work of the Spirit is akin to dispensationalism, if you think about it. Because by saying that God communicating with us and guiding us in the Spirit was only for back then, is really dispensational in nature. It's also a product of modern rationalism, which seeks to remove all supernatural elements from the Bible. And this is just one aspect of it, which has crept in to the churches. In Mark 13, Jesus tells the disciples that under trial and tribulation, the Holy Spirit will speak through them, and that they are not to meditate upon what they say. This is significant in Mark 13, because Jesus was not only speaking to the apostles, which he was, because that happened to them, but the context of Mark 13 is specific instructions to believers during the end times. So this is called dual prophecy, where there's an immediate prophetic context at that present time to the apostles, as well as future prophecy about end times events. So take a look at Mark 13, starting at verse 9. "But take heed to yourselves, for they shall deliver you up to councils, and in the synagogues ye shall be beaten, and ye shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them. And the gospel must first be published among all nations. But when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what ye shall speak, neither do ye premeditate, but whatsoever shall be given you in that hour, that speak ye, for it is not ye that speaketh." Sorry, I lost my place there. "For it is not ye that speak, but the Holy Ghost." So it is not ye that speak, but the Holy Ghost. Okay, very powerful words there. In verse 12, "Now the brother," and this is how we know it's about end times. This is how we know it's not just talking to the apostles. In verse 12, "Now the brother shall betray brother to death, and the father the son, and children shall rise up against their parents and shall cause them to be put to death." This is talking about the end times. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Speaking about the tribulation period, saints who will be physically saved, who endure until that very end. Not speaking of salvation, but that they'll live through that tribulation period. So again, you know, Paul is saying the Holy Ghost will speak through you. Don't meditate upon what you say when you're brought under trial during the tribulation. Important instruction for us to have if we're living near that time or in that time. So the false teaching that the Holy Spirit became dumb after the apostles died is dangerous error being promulgated by fundamentalists, cessationists, and some dispensationalists. And that's one of the reasons, you know, we're Baptists, but we don't call ourselves fundamentalists or fundamental or IFB, independent fundamental Baptists. There are several reasons for that. But, you know, we're not IFB, just to make that distinction. We're simply independent Baptists. Now, we believe in the fundamentals of the core gospel, of the Word of God, you know, that, you know, salvation is by faith alone, once saved, always saved. All the core teachings that Jesus is God in the flesh, that there's no other way to God, you know, except through him. We believe in all that. We're fundamental in the true sense of the word. Not in the sense that the IFB uses it, which is to bring in their own traditions and their own man-made rules of, you know, how to start churches or how to, you know, how to interpret what, you know, this issue of the Holy Ghost. There's so many issues that they twist and they turn out of context, and I'm not going to put up with it in this church. You know, we're going to stand firm even against attacks that I know will come simply because of this sermon, you know, and has already come. But we are independent Baptists to the core. We reject the man-made traditions and teachings of men that deny the work of the Holy Spirit. Acts 2 is another example of the pouring, of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. When the day of Pentecost, Peter and the apostles preached the gospel in foreign languages in Acts 2, starting at verse 16. This is a major, you know, verse on the outpouring of the Spirit, which they misinterpret. They partially interpret correctly, and we're going to look at that. Acts 2, verse 16. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens, I will pour out in those days, speaking of the end times, of my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in heaven above, and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. Again, going to the very end of times in that verse. So there are supernatural outpourings of the Holy Ghost that are going to be happening in the end times. But cessationists will point to Joel 2, which this passage is actually referring back to. They're correct in saying that. But here's where they go into error. They claim that Joel 2 was completely fulfilled at that day at Pentecost in Acts 2. But what they miss is that the Joel 2 prophecy began at the day of Pentecost with Acts 2, but it's not yet been culminated, has not been yet fully fulfilled until Jesus Christ returns himself at the second coming. This goes along with when the perfect shall come, then prophecy will be done away with, not until the second coming. The gifts will not end until that time. So Joel 2 has only partially been fulfilled, and God continues to speak by the Holy Ghost. God continues to give dreams and visions and speak forth words of knowledge to his people for the edification of his church. And so I'd like to just end with one final personal testimony, which was an example in my own life where I can't deny the work of the Holy Ghost. And there are more passages, but, you know, there's only so much I can cover in one sermon. So, you know, I think we broke down a lot of their false teachings in terms of the verses that they use. It's clearly, extraneous to the context. It's clearly clearly adding private interpretation to the Word of God. It's clearly denying the work of the Holy Spirit, and sometimes attributing it to Satan, which is blasphemy. So I just want to advise people to be careful, when someone does something by the Holy Ghost and you attack them or speak against the Holy Ghost in that way. So with that admonishment in mind, I just want to end with one final story, which was just incredible, where I can't deny that the Holy Ghost times events and works and speaks to his people at his discretion. And it had to do with the Fukushima incident. Fukushima, the great earthquake that happened, the tsunami that occurred after that, and the subsequent nuclear meltdown. So we were living back in California. The year was 2011. And for about 2 weeks, I had this overwhelming wave of anxiety washing over me almost daily. And I knew it was from the Holy Ghost. Now, the Holy Ghost comforts. Okay, so that's normally what we get. But I had this wave just coming over me, and it felt as though something horrific was about to happen. And all I could think about in the spirit was that there was going to be a massive earthquake. And because we lived at California at the time, I automatically assumed that God was going to send a major earthquake to California. That was my first thought. When I hear massive earthquake living in California, you think that, California is going to go into the ocean one day, which I don't want to scare anyone, but that's the rumor, right? And, so that was what was going through my mind. I just felt like there's a great earthquake coming. And I told my wife, and I told Marshall, and I said, I just feel like there's this great earthquake that's about to hit. And I kept hearing this phrase in my mind. I kept hearing, "Comfort my people, for I am about to trouble the waters." And I thought, I was getting specific words, and I'm thinking, trouble the waters? What does that even mean? I just had no idea. And I told my wife, I told Brother Marshall, I told them that phrase, and I said, there's going to be a major earthquake and God is going to trouble the waters. And then I just kind of forgot about it because, weeks went by and I went about my life and, I felt good and things were just fine. And, but then about a week later, I was asleep in bed, and about 11:30 at night, I was just woken. I just woke up, and that same exact wash, that feeling of like the spirit washing over me, came over me, and I just thought, oh no, there it is again. And I felt like this massive earthquake was coming, kind of like a wave, like these pre-tremors. And as I woke up and I heard God's voice again say, "Comfort my people, for I am about to trouble the waters." And then God tells me, turn to Psalm 46. And I'm thinking, Psalm 46, because I still didn't know what he was saying. So I turned to Psalm 46. Go ahead and turn there if you like. And I had no idea what was in Psalm 46. And I'm gonna call Marshall up after this sermon just to verify if what I say is true. Because I, with something like this, you should have a witness, and if you don't believe us, you don't believe us. But this is, I testify in the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord, that this is exactly as it happened. Psalm 46, I start reading, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will we not fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, Selah." And the psalm goes on, but I thought, I'm in bed, woken up, hearing these words, and I'm going, there it is. It's confirmed by the scripture where it says, "Though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof." And I'm thinking, oh no, we're we're in a heap of trouble because we're in California. This major earthquake is coming. I didn't know where it was going to hit. This is all I knew at the time. And I'm thinking, Lord, when is this coming? When is this going to happen? And as I start praying, I hear him say, tomorrow. And I'm going, tomorrow? Like, how are you going to protect us? What are you going to do? I can't just pack up my family and just start driving somewhere. And I didn't feel the compulsion to do that. I just trusted God. And I said, Lord, what are you going to do? And he didn't say another word, just nothing, no answer to that. And after that, I just went into a deep sleep. The Spirit came over me in the middle of praying. I just fell asleep. And the very next thing I knew, Mary, my wife, had gotten up before me that day and had turned on the news. And the very next thing that I knew after I fell asleep is she was shaking me awake, going, wake up, wake up. There's been a massive earthquake and a tsunami, and this, all the waters from the tsunami are heading towards the coast. And of course, we know this led to the subsequent nuclear meltdown in Fukushima. And at that time, or somewhere around that time, I was having dreams of nuclear material in the oceans. And so all of this was coming together, and I was kind of freaked out, honestly. I'm kind of glad to be out of California, because that place is just a wicked hub of, iniquity. And I'm concerned about the judgment there. But, this happens, and I'm thinking, why would God tell me this? Why was God sharing this with me? One is to show me that he speaks. One is to give you this testimony. And another thing is that, that Japan earthquake in Fukushima was so catastrophic that the nuclear meltdown continues even to this day to contaminate the Pacific Ocean. And we're like 5 years later now, about, or 4 or 5 years later, it's still leaking. I don't even eat fish from the Pacific Ocean usually if I can help it, because I'm concerned about that nuclear waste in the oceans. And I know it's probably getting filtered out to some extent. The ocean is huge, but I'm concerned. I don't just eat any fish that I find. Anyway, but that's a side point. But the point is that God has testified. So come up here, Marshall, and just, say something, or just nod assent, or whatever you want to do. But is what I said true? I mean, I'd like a witness to this.
Yeah, I was there for all of those three personal testimonies. The girl on the campus who got saved, the earthquake, when I got saved, and Fukushima. The Lord led Pastor Yakton to know about those things before it happened.
Yeah, so there's been many instances like that. People are going to say, this stuff doesn't happen, but I am a firm believer that it does. And it's really at God's discretion when and if he chooses to give someone a word or a prophecy or a vision or a dream. We can't make him talk to us the way that the Pentecostals think, but through deep prayer and fasting and the study of his word, Paul tells us to covet spiritual gifts. And he says that. He says in 1 Corinthians 14:1, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy. And so there are steps that we can take in hopes of receiving such gifts. Cultivate a deep prayer life with fasting and the study of God's written word. Abstain from the voices of the world that drown out the voice of God. Turn off the television, turn off the worldly music, even most of the so-called Christian music, just turn it off. It's drowning out you from hearing God and being in deep prayer. Take that time to pray instead. Get offline for a bit, go into the wilderness or into your secret closet, your prayer closet, and pray. And also understand that these types of supernatural gifts aren't for every believer. There are different administrations of gifts for different parts of the body, is what Paul says. So don't feel bad if you've never heard God in the Spirit. It doesn't mean that you're not approved of God. And it's not like you have to have these things to prove your salvation, like the Pentecostals teach. But if this is something you earnestly desire, pray and ask God to impart spiritual gifts to you for the purpose of the edification of the church. Paul says, remember, he says, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles, have all the gifts of healing, do all speak with tongues, do all interpret, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way, which is following after charity, which should be our number one goal as believers. So let's just end with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise your holy name. Thank you for speaking to us and showing us supernatural things that edify us and encourage us and increase our faith, God, especially in these end times when the church is falling away and believers' love have waxed cold, God. Thank you that you encourage us through such perilous times, and things are only going to get worse, God. Help us to rely on your Spirit and your Word combined so that we can live as saints of God, ready to do your work and to preach your gospel. We thank you and we praise your holy name. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.